What's up, mathematicians? Justin here. Welcome back to our unit on logic. This is lesson number 4, conditionals. But I'd actually like to start out the video by talking about how much my daughter loves books. Seem a little off topic? Yeah, maybe, I know. But it will connect, you'll see. For a while, my daughter, you know, she would occupy herself by looking at books for quite a good amount of time. And by the time she was maybe 2.5 years old, she had just memorized all of her favorite books. So she could just, you know, read them to herself. And okay, how can I resist but show you a little sample of that?
Then we head home to those marshmallows by the fire.
That's marshmallows, by the way.
They never come to shoot these birds on every flower. And the lambs are born.
Oh, shoot. See, wasn't that a valuable use of 20 seconds of your time? So a few months back, my wife and I were talking about how, you know, we're a bit of a bookish family. And then my wife says to our daughter, Mira, Mira, are you bookish? And Mira says, no. And then my wife says, well, if you're bookish, then you like books. Mira says, I am bookish. And then stops and thinks for a couple of seconds and is like, if I don't like books, then I'm not bookish. To which I say, excitedly, that's correct. So you might be thinking, what does all this have to do with conditionals? Well, it turns out that Mira's statement of, if I don't like books, then I'm not bookish, is another form of that original statement, if you're bookish, then you like books. Okay, so this statement right here is what we call a conditional. Now, before we unpack the connection between those different forms of conditionals a bit further, we need to talk about what a conditional is. So what is a conditional? Well, a conditional is a statement or a proposition with the form, if something, then something. So you have an if part and a then part. And a couple examples would be these. So here's one example of a conditional. If someone lives in LA, then they live in California. And another one, the one that we've been talking about in this video, if you're bookish, then you like books. Now, for a conditional to be true, the second part, the then part, needs to follow from the first part, the if part. In other ways to say this is that in a true conditional, the first part must imply the second part. So in this case, this conditional, if someone lives in LA, then they live in California, is true if you're talking about Los Angeles, California, right? There are other cities called Los Angeles, but if you're talking about LA, California, then this is a true conditional. The second one, we might have to look a little more closely at definitions to get a solid handle on whether that one is true. Now, there are plenty of examples of false conditionals out there. So for example, if I gave you a conditional like, if my car is green, then I am bald. You know, that's not a true conditional. Those two things have nothing to do with each other. But in this lesson, we won't be so concerned with whether a conditional is true as we will be with the different forms of conditionals and the relationships between those forms. So let's do a quick rundown of the different forms of conditional statements. So here we go. We're going to start out with this one that we've been talking about. This is the original conditional. If you're bookish, then you like books. Now, there is another form of this conditional called the inverse. And the inverse is if you're not bookish, then you don't like books. So from the conditional to get the inverse, you negate the first part and also negate the second part. Then we have another form here called the converse. Now the converse is if you like books, then you're bookish. For this one, we switch the order. The if part becomes the then part, and the then part becomes the if part. And you may see this coming, but there's one more form in which you do both. That form is called the contrapositive. And in the contrapositive, you both switch the order and you negate both parts. Okay, so now let's take some time to unpack this a bit further by looking at the symbols that we can use to express these things in our notes. Okay, so here is the conditional statement that we are working with, and we are going to label the two parts of the conditional using variables. So this first part, the if part, I'm going to call this part A, and the second part, the then part, I'm going to call B. So A is the that you're bookish, and B is that you like books. So the original conditional is that bookish implies that you like books. Now, a way to write this with the variables and the symbol would be that A implies B. Now, this little symbol right here looks like an equal sign with an arrow at one end. That symbol means implies, okay? And now the inverse, what we do is we take the negation of both the first part and the second part. So not bookish implies don't like books. And in terms of how I write this symbolically, I use this little symbol right here for not. So not A implies not B. For the converse, we change the order. So we take part B and put it at the beginning. So like books implies bookish. And so symbolically, we could write that as B implies A. And finally, the contrapositive is where we do both of those things. We change the order and we negate both. I don't know if I'll have enough space to write the whole thing here, so I might take two lines. So let's see. This would be part B, so don't like books, the negation of part B, so don't like books, and implies, I'll do it this way. Don't like books implies not bookish. And then symbolically, we would write that as not B implies not A. Okay, so we have our four forms, the original conditional, and then three other forms of that conditional. Now, one of these other three forms is equivalent to the original conditional. It has the same truth value. And I would challenge you to try to figure out which one it is. In fact, if you're not sure, you could come up with different conditionals and try them out, play around with it a little bit. In fact, maybe even pause the video and do that. I'm going to show you one more example before I tell you which one it's equivalent to. But I encourage you to try to figure that out yourself first. Okay, for our second example, I'm going to use that other conditional that I showed you earlier, that if someone lives in LA, then they live in California, and we will again label this here. This will be A, and this part two, the then part, will be B. So living in LA, or we could just say being in LA is A, and being in California is B. So of course, the conditional is that if you're in LA, it implies that you're in California. And symbolically, we write that as A implies B. The inverse, I take the negation of both. So not in LA implies not in California. And so I'll write that as not A implies not B. The converse, of course, I swap the order, switch LA and California. And so I say, okay, in California implies in LA. And symbolically, I'll write that as B implies A. And finally, our contrapositive, the last form that we're talking about today, is negating and switching the order. So not in California implies not in LA. And let's see, do we have space to write this? I should have used different colors. Oh well. So not B implies not A. And maybe I'll just draw a little line through to help delineate these things. So over here on this side of the line, I have the statements. And then over here, I have them written symbolically using A for living in LA and using B for living in California. Okay, so now what I'm wondering is, have you figured out which one of these three is equivalent to the first one? Okay, and one way to go about this is by trying to find counterexamples, like thinking about each one and playing around with trying to find some counterexamples to it. So we look at the first one, and this conditional is true if we're talking about Los Angeles, California, right? Which is not the only Los Angeles, but that's the one in, you know, Southern California where I live. So that's the one I'm referring to here. So if you're in LA, then you are in California, because Los Angeles is completely contained within the state of California. So this is a true conditional. Now, the inverse, if you're not in LA, then you're not in California, is not true, right? Because you could not be in LA, but you could be in Oakland, for example, or San Francisco, or Sacramento, or a variety of any of other cities that are in California, and still be in California. So what that tells us is that the inverse is not logically equivalent to the conditional. Now, sometimes students get this a little confused and will say, oh, the inverse isn't true. That's not the way to think of it. The way to think of it is that the inverse and the conditional do not have the same truth value. In other words, it's possible for the conditional to be true and the inverse to be false, and vice versa. We could have one where the inverse is true and the conditional is false. That is possible, meaning these two are not equivalent. Now let's move on to the converse. Okay, so the converse is, if you're in California, you're in LA. Well, the same counterexamples work here, right? So if you're in Oakland, then you are in California. But if you're in Oakland, you're not in LA. So again, the converse is not logically equivalent to the conditional, which brings us to the last one, which is, of course, the one that we're looking for, the contrapositive. So the contrapositive says, if you're not in California, then you're not in LA. And that's true, because LA is completely inside California. So if you're outside California, there's no way you can be inside LA. So the conditional and the contrapositive are logically equivalent. They have the same truth value, meaning that if the conditional is true, the contrapositive has to be true, and vice versa. And also, if the conditional is false, the contrapositive has to be false, and vice versa. Okay, so another way to phrase this is that the conditional is true if and only if the contrapositive is true. But what do I mean by if and only if? Well, that sounds like a topic for another video. So in the next video, we will look at this idea of logical equivalence and understand what this if and only if term means. As always, thank you so much for watching. If you did learn something today, please do like and subscribe, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye-bye.